是。 He changes the whole form.
That's why I like the
Thank you. When did you drive down?
We drove down yesterday. Yeah, absolutely.
I'm up to 10:30 at night. It was terrible the whole way. Broke a half lane. Big chopped up truck.
Do you know that Jason or Bill?
Bill. I'm Bill.
I knew it would be Bill.
See, you talking to Dad a while ago. I mean, right away.
He's Rick the Rat?
Yeah.
Is he coming?
He's probably having a cigarette or something. I don't know. He's here.
A lot of these pieces I haven't seen in years, but I can't remember who
that. Right.
They were younger then. You know, they get white with age.
Don't we all?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, I...
Yeah, right. This right here in the front is a nice sun. Yeah.
Is Jason in there?
He's somewhere around here, too. But this is his son. All right.
Picture of the sled.
Thank you.
I don't know what to do. I can't get it to work. I got it and then back to that. Shit. Again, I'll leave it alone. What the hell is going on?
Okay, good. Oh, perfect.
Well, I don't understand what's going on. I can't like that. Watch me. Well.
Oh, okay. Oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah, the damn thing. Hi, y'all. I'm muted.
Thank you. Starting the service in just a moment, we'll have the entrance song that's going to play now while Debbie brings the family in, and then the service will be starting now with the entrance song.
From your mother's shame. Okay. Oh. I thought it needed this. I touched it before and it didn't do anything. So I thought, oh, maybe we need the cursor. Oh, no. So now it's muted, huh? Yeah, so we can.
Right, that's what I'm trying to do.
Say, yeah, I'm gonna. Frustration, you just walked in the room.
Yeah.
You have to learn to at least deal with people, Thomas. Okay, yeah, what's the deal? You don't need to be all ridiculous. There's a chat thing. Well, we can't hear anything. If we're there, we should be able to hear it. When Carol goes on things, she talks to people. She's at a meeting or something. You did too, didn't you?
Well, yeah, but that was a meeting. You know? It's not, if you got a million people, you can't.
You don't. Participants, 100.
Hi, folks.
See, he's talking. Get him talking.
I just want to welcome you all here to Lance Mackey's service.
Oh, turn it up.
Celebration of life.
Can you hear him? He's
celebrate Lance's life. To give a little introduction of what we're going to be doing today, I'm going to be introducing Chaplain.
For the lady who is talking, please mute yourself.
And then after that, we're going to have a. We have a song by John over here that he wrote about Lance.
Okay, can you hear it?
Incredible. Yeah. Well, something. Then we'll have a tribute video for Lance. And I'm going to have two comments. After my comments, I'm going to introduce the family is going to come up. So I want you to think about it. We need, we're going to talk about Lance. We're going to talk about his life and memories. And I'm encouraging as many of you as possible to come up and share stories. Sorry, I know a lot of people don't like to speak in public. If you can come up here, we've got this all on the Zoom. And so all of the people worldwide that love Lance and are here to, with us through the Zoom so they can see everything that way. After that, after the words from the family, I got a little poem that I'm going to read because over the summer, Lance asked me many times to read this to him. So I'm going to share that. And then Chaplain Dave will come up with a final blessing. And then we'll have the recessional. And afterwards, you know, we have the reception hall set up here. And sharing everything else. No one, most of the people in this crowd, I'm expecting there's going to be some really good stories out there. And hey, you can tell any of them. This isn't a church anymore. So I'd like to, first of all, on behalf of my darling wife, Debbie, and our entire staff, I want to thank the Mackey family for entrusting Lance to our care. You know, I'd do every hard thing I've ever done in my life, 1,000 times over, just to be there to help a friend. And I know most of you are the same way. So on behalf of the family, thank you all very much for coming to the service to commemorate Lance, great guy. And so with that, before I start blubbering, Chaplain Dave is going to come up and start the service. Thank you. Thank you, man. Oh, I guess now we're going to have a song, How Great Thou Art. I think they heard that.
You are so good. You see the world. The world is so Good afternoon. Thank you all for taking the time on behalf of the family to come out and remember and honor and celebrate the life of Lance Mackey. I'm going to share some thoughts with you today. I wish I could do it in Grant Heisler's voice. I feel like that's the famous more appropriate, sort of the narrator of Alaska. Trying to describe Lance at a service for Lance is a very daunting task. The good news for me is I know it's impossible to do it adequately, so that's been pretty recent. Lance was a brother. He was a father, a grandfather, a husband, and a son. Lance loved his family. He loved his state. He loved his dogs. Speaking with Dick this week, Lance has always been a people person, and people have always been drawn to him. Lance was raised on a dog lot. His knowledge, understanding, and his bond with his dogs developed at a very early age. In 2001, when Lance was so sick with his first round of cancer, it was ultimately his dogs that pulled him through. His sister was known to sneak a dog into his hospital room on more than one occasion. That victory over the first round of cancer was a pivotal moment in Lance's life. It gave him not only a new appreciation for his life, but it gave him a new understanding of his own mental strength. In 2005, the legend of Lance Mackey was born. When he won the first of what would become four consecutive Yukon Quests, it was an unprecedented feat that was somehow exponentially magnified when in 2007 and 8, he won the Yukon Quest and the Iditarod in the same year. I think all of us who are not dog mushers are a little bit, we question the sanity of mushers in general, but to do both of those in 1 year back to back is a phenomenal feat. Lance went on to win 2 more Iditarods, ultimately winning each race 4 consecutive times. This was excellence at a new level. This was Lance's greatness. Dick has said Lance never sat down and analyzed things or pre-planned out in great detail his next move or what was to come. He just went. And he ably adapted to every moment as it presented itself. Lance had an extraordinary will, an extraordinary desire, and an extraordinary drive. On winning multiple Iditarods, as we've seen as a program, he was quoted as saying, if you're going to dream, dream big. It was never easy. Of the 2008 race with Jeff King in pursuit, Lance was quoted as saying, I didn't have anything left. I left my reserve out there. If it came down to a foot race between him and I, he was going to get me because there was nothing. Competitors would say they didn't know what Lance had. It was clearly different. Dick says Lance was a master at knowing exactly where the red lines were on all of his dogs and staying on the correct side. Jeff King, you may be here today. I didn't know I'm giving credit for this quote, but I'm stealing it. He has been quoted as saying that Lance Mackey is to mushing what Mozart is to music. And it's hard not to be in awe of his talent, of his gift. That's tremendous praise from a fellow legend. Over the last year or so, cancer has returned to Lance's body, and ultimately this time, it would mark the end of his trail. I have been asked to share with you Psalm 23, as David reminds us of the comfort provided by the Lord, our great shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So many people admired Lance. So many were inspired by Lance. So many loved Lance. When the one we love dies, our love for them does not die. It turns to grief. How do we process it? What do we do with it? This varies greatly from person to person. But I want to share with you a couple of verses from Ecclesiastes 3, where we're reminded there is a season and a time for everything under heaven. Verse 2 reminds us that there's a time to be born and a time to die. Verse 4 reminds us there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Our culture urges us to push past, to suppress, to fix, to get over, to be strong, muscle through it, hide our pain, hide our grief. I want to encourage all of you to give grief its due time, to give grief its due process. There is a time for grief and that time is right now. Grieve well, but do so knowing that soon there will be a time to laugh, and soon there will be a time to dance again. Remember, our grief is there because it is our love. Lance Mackey leaves behind a tremendous legacy. Lance will be remembered for his humanity, his toughness, his resilience, and his excellence. To the Mackey family, the family, the Brits, and their state, Creekwood. He loved well. He raised well, and he made an entire state proud. We will always remember Lance Mackey. Thank you. At this time, I would like to introduce to you John Schufeld Jr., who's going to share with us his song, The Legend of Lance. So, not really one for speeches, so I'd just like to say thank you guys for this honor. I knew Lance. Every time I see him, I call him a legend. And he can have this little smirk on his face every time I call him that. But, a lot of people thank me for writing this. And I honestly, it wrote itself. Me and my buddy, you and I were talking. He said, you should write a song called The Legend of Lance. And so he kind of threw out some words. And I sat down that night. And, this song just came out in like 20 minutes. And I recorded the video. After I was done, I was like, man, the hell just happened? I couldn't believe it. I was like, I literally, honestly, God, you know, this song really wrote itself. And you know, it hit home for a lot of people. So I have to have the words in front of me because, like, I wrote it, I recorded it, and I watched it the next day, and I was like, and I don't even remember writing that line, so this is a Legend of Lance.
is for 1,000 miles, and the end's eternity. Yes, I've been a rambling man, wandering along. My heart is stuck to wild old dog, the place where I come home. I hit a bruise for the money, the bills for my own. Never live, you never take a chance. This is a legend of the land. I used to use a whiskey bottle to ease all the pain. Remedy, yes, and just to get back up again. I live a thousand nights like this. For a thousand nights to the brain. Doctor said you have your day for what you gonna do. I'm a little life that's free to me. I hope it's safe for you. You never know when your time is up. After all that you've been through.
So after this is when we're going to open it up to the family comments. And again, Chaplain Dave will be coming up and reading some comments from Dick and CM, and then others from the family will be coming up. And when the family after they speak, you know, we want to make sure, like I said, that you know, we can maybe line up in this hallway over here or something in this aisle. And just so, you know, don't be shy about coming up and speaking. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of his friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first he had the date of birth and spoke of the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years, for that dash represents all the time he spent alive on earth, and now only those who love him know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? Or you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand the way other people feel, and be less quick to anger, and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect, and more often wear a smile, remembering that this little batch might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is read, with your life's actions to rewatch, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? And I thought this was appropriate because right now we're going to hear from family and then all your friends, as many of you that can come up. And let's hear about how Lance spent his dash. And gentlemen, or do we have a song again? Or? No, we don't have a song. Sorry, I just don't know if you know that.
So that will come up with the read from family. Yeah, two letters to read. The first would be from CN. For those who don't know me, I'm CN. I'm not usually at a loss for words, but I have struggled to find my voice. I first met Lance 15 years ago. Like many, I was a fan of Lance Matthews. Through the years, I got to know Lance as a friend. As the friendship grew and our bond deepened, we shared the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. Lance was a supernova. His was the brightest light in the room. His laughter was contagious. He had the ability to make those around him feel as though they were the most important person in the room. At some point, our friendship grew to love. We spoke often of the friendship that spanned many years gave us the ability to navigate the fight of his life. From the moment of his most recent diagnosis until the end of his journey, Lance never said, "Why me?" He never gave up hope, and he never stopped fighting for our future with agony and motive. Lance refused to let the physical limitations of his illness dictate our life. On our last camping trip, we sat around a roaring fire toasting marshmallows. Lance was wearing an oxygen mask. He caught fire. He ended up rolling on the ground. Adigan ran into the motorhome and said, "Lolo, get up on fire." Very calmly, Lolo said, "Really?" Such was the life of Lance. In the coming weeks, as the family begins to resume our lives and define the new home, the focus will be on Adigan and Lolo. The family remains committed to honoring the legacy of their two loving parents. Lance and I were to be wed last Saturday in the beautiful morning. Sadly, God had other plans. As it became apparent that Saturday might not happen, we exchanged vows and rings in a special ceremony. I love you, Lance, and will carry you in my heart always. So we'll interject one personal anecdote that I've shared with Dick and a couple other family members. One sound I think we may have heard on September 7th was Lance's guardian angel slapping him in the mouth. I think there were a few stories where that's one possible angel. Okay, lastly, I'd like to read before other families. This is a letter from My wife and I have lost a son. Words alone cannot describe the despair and loss that leaves. Young children and some with their own children have lost their dad, grandchildren, their grandmother. Brothers and sisters have lost their brother. The list of the hurt just goes on and on. Lance was claimed by our extended family and shared with the world. I think our nation, along with the entire mushroom world, have lost a mushroom of extraordinary glory. The car racing community has lost a driver of that same caliber. Longtime friends and those that knew him only through social media or videos mourned his passing. A lasting has lost a true lasting. We may take some degree of comfort knowing he and his sister are once again running dogs together. Kathy and I thank each of you for being here to grieve with our family and celebrate Lance's life. All right, it's always hardest to be the first.
Well, I think most of you know me. If anyone doesn't, I'm in that, the oldest brother.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank all of you for being here. I'm sure you would appreciate it. I does appreciate it. I'm going to try to not cry, so.
Good luck.
Yeah. But you know, Lance was a real inspiration to a lot of other questions. And right on up to some of his competitors. You know, and Lance is pretty good. Pulling it off real late, which did do things that myself and Dad and Bill Cotter and all the soul boys we never thought possible. Dogs only dogs. Oh, but the thing is, Lance's dogs, they had to get stuff with him. That's how they run. He didn't make schedules. He didn't plan out a lot. He told me, I just run by the seat of my pants. As long as they're behind me, that's good. And it worked. And, he was so driven and determined, even prior to his first stroke cancer. You know, he was young man out there fishing. I've heard stories and all the waves are so tall and the screws on his ship went up real quick. And that's those ones on, he'd go by himself. Okay? Well, sure, it does. This is the kind of guy he was. He was a hero to a lot of people, especially kids. I've worked at a school now for over the past 17 years. And when that's one of his first two conquests, Patty and I, Roland, he was just a little guy, our son. We're at the finish, and you know, all the reporters and cameras and all around the land. And I usually try to shy away from that kind of stuff. So, Patty and I were looking at the dogs, we took a few degrees off, that kind of thing. And Roland goes, oh, you'll see over the lamps. I go, well, okay, you go up there. Just tell him you did a good job. And so I watch him go up there, he's a little kid. He's up there, he's kind of talking about that spark there, and the people are all here. Lance looks down and says, roll it through. Where's the telephone, Lance? Lance keeps having a little smile, you know, kind of rubs Roland's hat. Yeah, here it was. Never says. Went to school Monday. He was in third or fourth grade. And of course, he told all the kids. Man, Lance had more heroes. So anyway, that was a lot of fun. But anyone who ever raced against him, I know he won BCB. If they couldn't outrun him, or if he couldn't outrun him, he'd figure out something. You know? Many times he'd come back for a couple of them, I did a lot of things. Oh man, I gotta get past him. I'm just not past him. I'm like, well, what the heck? Just one. Is that fast? Over. So, you know, kind of like, he just laid it back. And of course, myself, I've got pump circulation, so I smoke cigarettes in 50 years, but nothing like Lance has. And we were at Two Rivers 200-mile race, and it was pretty cold out. You know, it was 25, 30 below. And my son-in-law, Will, and Lance is the first two to come into the checkpoint. They went ahead of the rest of them. And so, you know, now it's time to do the chores and stuff. Well, Lance got the straw out and he's got his big mitts on. I'm standing back watching. Bill's over there speeding through it, no problem. Young man with good circulation. And so Lance, I start watching him. It takes one minute off. And he had, like you saw in the picture, half gloves. And he's going to do a couple tight lines, take a few booties off, and he stick his hand back that bit. And he's going up the line like this. So I go, you got some pinnacle heaters in those mitts? Oh, yeah, 10 bits. I fixed the mitt for a day to put my hand in. Hey, it was 80 degrees. And he already had 10 of them little pinnacle heaters.
No. That's the extra stuff.
Yeah, you know. You know, race, I did a lot of stuff enough. You know, you do race like that, but and being tough, I forget which race it was. Himmerpato, all the guys went over to Costco, and we come back, and of course, he has extra dogs, and we'll be 16. He needs a long run to eliminate you. And so this is probably a week and 10 days before I did arrive. And he comes down to me now. And phone is about 8:30 at night. It's dark out. He looks up 21 dogs. They're going handling back. That's 8 miles away. And he has one headlight. I have the same headlight, they're not like the ones they have these days. One rechargeable battery, it's not going to last until it gets daylight in the morning. So he knows he can't run his light all the time. And the first part of the trail is pretty easy for a big team. Getting over the head, though, he's not wax. But when he head out to Palavana, and it's windy, got the branches. It's a pretty wild piece of trail, particularly with 21 dogs, isn't it? And they had quite a bit of time off. They just got finished hustling. They were trying all of the dirt bike dogs. And he took 3 bottles of water with us, whole pack of cigars. And he had food for the dogs, but nothing for himself. And after the bottle, we got it. And sure enough, 8 mile run, it took over 6.5 hours. He's probably not taking a break. I mean, that's a long question, though. That's pretty good time. And, well, the dog went down and said, no, what do we do? Just turn around and back and forth. We need a few more steps. Got back in 7 hours. We didn't slow down. We still had 21 dogs. We had to kick out 5 before we could get the gun. So later that morning, Patty, she goes to work a little later, which is kind of a night shift, I feel. So it's about 11:30, 12 o'clock. Here, Lance is not on our little store, keeping him store. This is food. Well, Lance had just finished big pong, hash browns, sausage, toast, everything goes right. Then Patty comes in, sits down, and he's a little. Oh no, he has to talk in it. Let's turn to the cook. It's just really can't hear that. Can we do that again? Everything, all over. And even as a little boy, that's got to be. Yeah. Never be in the house, sorry. But It's just so hard to hurt you. You know how to deal with it. Well, I think, well, you can't do it forever. Well, I don't know if I'll do as good as Rick did without problems. Thanks everybody for coming. You have to be of all people. Glad to appreciate everybody being here.
Wouldn't miss it.
So I was gonna write something for this. I found myself just staring at a wet piece of paper. And no, when it's allowed, when the Lord said, that was his thing. Suck it up. So I'm going to do my best on sucking it up. No, all the memories, stories, the time spent with him on the trail, literally thousands of miles of training and racing with him. He taught me about everything I know. Remember him and I got dropped off at Moses Point. Most of you probably don't know where Moses Point is. It's on Norton Sound between Clayton and Newell. My mom dropped us off there in an airplane. I was 14, class of 16. She said, took me back for us in a day or so. That's where the comment the thanks that he used to make to me. Yeah.
Population 2.
Yeah, population 2. 3 years. And there was times like that, you just say, well, population 2, bro. Lance is probably the toughest guy I've ever known. And more than, you know, there's things that he, you just tough. I don't think there's never a time that he couldn't handle whatever was thrown at him. Except this time. We're going to miss it. We're all going to miss it. I don't know what else to say other than I love you, but I'll carry lines with me to know him this year. We've got some camp spots out there. We've camped more than once together. 2015, I helped Lance get to know him, which I thought was going to be his last race, so to be. It wasn't, which I'm glad. That's just the way he was. He never gave up. Shit, when in 2015, he couldn't even button his own pants or anything. I was there to assist him. I guess that's what you do. He was taken away too soon. I know that. 52 years young. That's not lots of good memories. And as a brother, you always have the differences. Anybody that has a brother, it's all that differences.
you can say you have in your life. You know, I thought I was driving down the road the other day. Probably the worst thing I could be doing is driving the site up to 12, 14 hours a day for the last week. Probably the dangerous person on the road. Many times it was felt myself coming for it, it seems. Yeah, it's always hearing in the back of my mind, suck it up, man. Yeah, I didn't know where I was going.
It's okay.
Yeah, good. You know what? I heard that Legend of Lamps song that does stop to think about the legends that we're looking down on us right now. Go back as far as Dick Toby, Grace Marshall in a race up in the sky right now. There's Joey. Lance, my mom, Larry Thompson, they're flying the trail for them. There's many others, I can't even think of them all. I had a bunch of them in my mind the other day. The hell of a race going on up there, I know that. Well, I'm not there for it, but there's a hell of a race.
A land we gave it a long time. Yeah, when I got the story out of Akron, Rossville, I come back that one way and we've been out of the boat long weeks. We did a long trip. I passed the bus up to Fairbanks and got the mountain water and Anchorage and back to the east. But when we were coming through Rossville, I go Fairbanks up. 5 o'clock traffic, rain as you have to go, black out of Kansas. And here on the side of the hill, you know, like we were sitting in a church. This poor guy, he's probably who it is. And I'm telling him, he said, Jim, what are you doing? I said, man, that guy is drunk. He's in a bad spot. You gonna turn around? Yeah. You gotta turn around. Got his hook up, he's got the jumper cable pulled up, and we're hooking up the field, and we just got each other, and we got the big hook. I always get the best hook. Superman. And he got that dog by the hind leg. And then we both had the dog. And as soon as we got that dog tied, he disappeared.
A few of you know I'm talking crowds, but for Lance, I'll do it. I'll do it. You know, a couple years ago, he went back east, and we were talking on the phone, he was back there. He was saying what great memories he has about himself and like me when we used to mush around up there in Dixon, Arden. Just those words alone telling me that. That's a better memory than all the memories I could even think of all the great times in my head and everywhere else we've been. Yeah, a few years ago too, we had this big family get together in Fairbanks, and surprisingly enough, Lance starts telling a story that happened way back in the 80s when him and I were up there. We fell through this ice that was like chest deep, and because of my sled bag, my sled was just bobbling all around like a fishing, you know, bother. And had to start cutting the tug lines and neck lines to snap some of that from those, throwing the dogs up on the ice. They all looked like rats that just came out of a sewer or whatever, so wet and so small and wet. And just kept throwing them towards Lance, and he'd throw them over in the snow. He was a little ways behind me, he didn't get quite as wet. Good friend of ours, Jen, and a few people know Pat Burrows up there in Wyson. He had a team too. He didn't get in the water near as bad as we did. So, anyways, here my dogs are kind of in the deep snow on this cliff, just thrown everywhere. Lancing for tie off for a harness. So, we had to keep breaking that ice in front of my sled to pull it up to the trail where Pat was waiting for us. The three of us somehow took his team like 5 miles to the cabin. And, you know, one would be running behind, two would be standing on the runner's pump, and a guy that had like six or eight dogs. So we built this big old bonfire. Before I know it, back of my carcass on fire. And then Lance's bunny started to melt. So next day, we go, daylight, whatever. We take that team, get back over there in that canyon there, right above that place we saw Peggy's cabin on the north part of Cuenca. And we get up there, well, Charlie Breck's cabin, and we could see where we had broke the ice to pull that sled 100 yards or whatever to the trail. And it all froze back together. But, you know, this was thin ice with like chest deep water and then thin river ice. So we tell Pat, okay, you get the wise man, you tell everybody what's going on. It's going to take us quite a while. So Lance and I, we start walking across there. Pretty soon we realize we're not going to fall through, just the two of us walking. And I start goofing around, you know, I'm like 22 or whatever. And he's, you know, quite a bit younger. And like I said, I was older than that because he was older too. Anyway, so, but still, I'm in my 20s and he's barely 19 or whatever. And he's more like 16 and everything. And so we're joking around, and I'm like bumping into him. And we know we're not going to fall through. He's like, stop it, stop it. Don't do that. We're going to fall through. And finally, we get up there. Like, my sled is behind us now on the trail. And my tug lines are cut. My neck lines are cut. So we grab my dogs, and we start hooking mine and his team. So, of course, every dog, just either they're going to have a neck line or they're going to have a tug line, one or the other.
and get his team up to my sled. Somehow we get the two sleds to go in here. I don't know how we ever got the Wiseman so quick behind Pat. He barely had time to tell everybody what would happen. But, just Rancho back east a couple of years ago, and we were talking. And, that's just one of the stories he really he remembered and always talked about. A lot of other good stories. One time, our dad was on the supply run with a big truck in town. I don't know, Kathy stayed home that time. She let Lance and take these two snow machines out trail breaker. I think we were just out goofing around more than anything else. oil injector line, it was so cold out, it froze up. And that was the long track machine that I was on. So we had to double up on that little short track machine. A few days later, we went out and got that taken care of. But yeah, Lance, what a tough guy. What a dog musher. A lot of drive. Like Rick was saying, Lance's dogs had to be as tough as Lance. And they had a hard time doing that. But Lance was one tough guy. And I'm sure going to miss him. Thank you very much.
We don't normally do this. Bill said I'll do it for once. Did it from a mother of mine not that long ago. He's like, we're doing this quite a bit. I always have something to say. just want to point out that I was supposed to be watching the game last Sunday with my brother. My Chargers kicked his Ravens ass. Sorry. We were not blood siblings, but blood is not a family name. Our parents have been married for over 40 years. That's family. I left home quite early, so I didn't get to spend a whole lot of time. But we started at Coldfoot hanging out like that. See him once in a while when I came up, but I didn't really follow him from afar. He had his cancer that kept me up to date. Remember, I was in California sitting in a hotel alone in the middle of the night to watch him when this person was just sitting there falling like a baby. So, it's been recently that we've actually been able to spend a lot more time together. And had to go rescue his ass at Lowe's. and then he didn't have the truth to remember. You what? You drove my motorhome? Where? Yeah, my house. You start with a stick. But we had a good memorial weekend, even though he was resting. And he was able to hide. It was his hiding place. He'd just come there and nobody knew where they were, and they could just
relaxed. And then I had to go chase his dogs. Just the neighborhood. And decided he was going to run off, and I was trying to catch him, and I'm like, what the hell am I getting? The dogs run thousands of miles. some lovely couple did wind up days later. I don't know where Addy and Moses are, but I don't know if Jen's parents are listening, but just so that they know, we all love those kids and we will continue to take care of them as we have. We all have hurtful things that we do. Hot salads, running to school, fishing. Depending with Uncle Ricky and mine, I know Lance wanted so badly to take them camping and fishing this year and watch him catch their first fish. Uncle Ricky and I did that, but he didn't want to fish. I have something to do with the right time because I'm not really good at words. most of you may know her. You may not know her, but it doesn't matter. Thank you, Anne. I didn't mean that horribly. But my dear friend and colleague from the hospital where I work, Anne Zink, she's the chief medical officer of the state of Alaska. My colleague, and most importantly, my friend. A week ago, I had to go in and go to work, and it was one day when she was there, and she just wrapped me in a big hug. And she was the best hug ever. And she asked if she could write something, and I wasn't sure if I wanted, and I said, yeah, something, and maybe I just thought she could write it, she's really good at stealing it. But I have to give her kudos for it. It's so beautiful. So this is from Anne. I have never had the honor of meeting Lance Mackey, but somehow when I heard of his death, it was like an eclipse of the sun, an unexpected darkening of something great, huge, energizing that brings light. And like an eclipse, my logical side tried to remind me that death finds us all, but somehow, like when the sun darkens in the middle of the day, Lance's death felt surreal. Unexpected, as if I expected he would overcome death, but he had overcome the impossible again and again throughout his life. Lance, in so many ways, was and is Alaska to me. Tough, raw, kind, flawed, giving, honest, larger, and more stunningly dramatic than you could comprehend. Life dealt Lance a rough hand, but again and again he would rise. He would show up for his dogs, for his kids, or for the race. Quitting or complaining never seemed to be an option. His grit seemed so strong, it could bend the impossible to the possible. He didn't sugarcoat life, and he didn't expect others to solve his challenges. He seemed vulnerable and tough as nails at the same time. And it was that duality that I think led him to be such a beloved Alaskan figure that why his passing has hit me and so many others. There is a Mexican notion of death. The first death comes when a person's body ceases to function. The second comes when the body is laid to the grave and the family remembers them. And the final death comes when the person's name is uttered for the final time. Philosopher Douglas Hollis, the Hofstadter, takes this notion further speaking of how the brightness of the light leads a glow of ember, and an afterglow in those that have been left behind, and it continues to ripple and whirl long after the person is left. But while the light flame of Lance's life has gone out, my sun darkened. And while today may be his second death, Lance was bright, bold, and intense, and his ember, the embers of his life, will burn on for generations to come. It will continue in cancer fighters, addiction enders, and change makers. It will continue in the hopes and dreams of aspiring mushers, athletes, and Alaskans. It will continue in his family and friends gathered here today who grieve the loss of a son, a brother, a father, and a friend. And I don't know where this is. And it will continue in this family and friends gathered here today who grieve the loss of a son, a brother, a father, and a friend. May we all choose to show up for life like Max did, embracing the beauty and the hardship with honesty and humility, not letting the little things on the trail bother us, and always putting the team that carries us first. Happy trails, Lance. Thank you for giving a life so bright it inspires even those you've never touched.
I'm Lance's younger sister, Chris, and one of my favorite Big Brother stories of Lance was from when I was 11 or 12, and Lance was 4 years older than me, so he had a head start on the ulterior motive game. That was almost the peak of our kennel numbers at Coldfoot. We had close to 100 dogs, and half of them were puppies. I took care of the puppies, and the boys, Lance and Jason, split the rest. I came down with mono that winter, and I was sicker than I'd ever been. At first, the boys just kind of ignored me, as was typical. But as I got sicker and got a permission longer, they started coming to visit me. And they'd come to sit at the edge of my bed, and I'm like, hey, how you doing? Feeling better? And I'm like, aw, that's so nice. But then my head cleared up a little. They came back the next day. Then I realized they weren't worried about it. The jerks were tired of doing my chores. So even though they were brats, for some reason I've always been protective of them. I think it was Anne said. He was strong, but he was also vulnerable. And I find myself telling cover stories to our parents or cleaning that bathroom so we wouldn't get front party, or coming to his defense when he did just really incredibly But I miss him. And while it was always a toss up whether he'd be on the front page of the police blotter. His hunger for living fully was unmatched and exhilarating to witness. Today I read a perspective of the day, and it was appropriate. Everything in this life is temporary. Everything that you're going through right now is not there to stay forever. Be it the good things and bad. So let yourself enjoy your moments, feel them deeply. And if things aren't working in your favor at the moment, remember, it's temporary. Everything will turn out the best way possible. You do you, one step at a time. And that was probably the most Lance thing I could think of. Like, he arranged that for me to see today. Because he was so, just move on, go to the next thing. It's okay. Thank you guys for being here. And I'm sorry, my brother. Almost as
good afternoon, everyone. My name is Wes, and Lance and Jason's youngest brother. I also appreciate you all being here. I never really had a passion for dog rushing, so when I smacked, I didn't connect on that level. But me and Lance, connected very well. He showed me a lot of things and a lot of different ways to get into trouble, and he was really good at getting us into trouble and getting us out of it. Jeff King, just watching the other day on a documentary, said, I don't know what he had, but it works. And I think I know. Lance had a remarkable ability to understand whether it was dogs or a race car or people of every walk of life. The man could reach out and find the connection. And it didn't matter what you were speaking to him about. There was something as mundane as a new pair of shoes, or quantum physics, he would find a way to meet you in the middle. I don't have a lot of stories that would be appropriate to talk about on this stage. But I do have a memory that makes me laugh just about every time. Lance fashioned himself a carpenter. I want to be an astronaut. But he couldn't put things together and watch that man build everything from a house made out of pallet boards and newspaper to a house that overlooked all the Fairbanks. And it was his throne on top of the mountain. I also watched that man build a front deck on that house, and I'm not going to lie, I didn't walk on it. Me and my wife Eden were staying up there for a time, and I came home and I was working at Big Street Construction, of all things. And I came home one day after work, and he was on top of the ladder building his deck. And I was leaning a little. And I walked up and looked up at him. You okay? You need some help? No, I got it. And I kept looking at this corner post that he's got. Kind of short. It was really short. Man, what the hell are you doing? And so I went up and peeked out the door. really wasn't impressed of trying to walk across that thing, but I did it. At the top of that post, it was short. And so we cut off another post and we just kind of put that together. And for years after that, every time I would go up there, when you walk up the driveway, I'd see that damn corner post. And I never fixed it. I swear to God, it was just fine. There's a lot of things that Lance was needed to understand. And I think the best thing he ever taught me was to understand that you just have to do. Like I said, I didn't share the dog much with him passionately, even though I've done plenty of running with him. And plenty of stupid. But I'm grateful that he taught me how to understand. And it's a lesson that I'll hold for me in Europe. So tonight, give one up to him and find a way to understand the people you love. And for the people that you can't understand, maybe try a little harder. Thank you.
While you were talking about getting you into trouble, I just want to be a little trouble after we have to resurrect my house.
Which what?
I did some one of the last things I told him. I said, thank you for that great time you showed me in your RV in my backyard. Yeah, we had a good time out in our RV, his RV. But I had a great time with my brother sitting there. The four of us, my husband, Sam, Lance, and I, and he's just giving me shit and all that. And of course, I'm living up to it. And legs weren't working real well. I had to call my husband and say, can you come get your light? We were 500 feet from the bathroom. So for the next few months, Lance continually gave me a really hard time about it. And the fact that, like, what in the hell happened to the car of your car? And I'm like, it's paint from the doorway of the garage. So he kept going on and on about that. So he was having a good time giving me that, spilling my purse, and he said, give me that back. And he goes, no, I don't even have the good stuff in there. But the one thing, I know he said it in front of me, and mostly that he mentioned it to. Yeah, I was thinking, if I can smile now, is Beagle. We didn't mention it. Yes, Beagle is a little dog. And Beagle has been around since his first bout of cancer 20 plus years ago. And he said about a week ago, he said, that little bastard's going to outlive me. And he did. Anyway, it's just a couple of funny things because I was up here.
And we're still alive.
And yeah, Beagle is yes. Yes, yes. I thought we were running around. So Beagle and Ham and Jackie. So yeah, the little bastard that way. start crying. So everybody knows Uncle Lance knows he's super funny and always such a good storyteller. One of the last races we were together was the 2020 Little Oak 300. And there's a beautiful trail from Trapper Creek over to Forks Roadhouse. And you're going along and saw these steep pitches in the riverbanks. I didn't think too much of it, but after the race, we're all sitting around having a good time and laughing. Lance says, man, what do you think about all those riverbanks? They're so steep, huh? I'm like, yeah, I guess so. And he says, well, I came upon this gal. Said she was on the other side on the steep part. Her sled was stuck. Her dogs were taking a nap. And he says, so I'm sitting there and I'm waiting and waiting to have a cigar. And my dogs are just screaming, ready to go. So he says, after a while, he got tired of waiting. And she's up there. And Lance is just so kind. Always when she's like, pulling on her brush coat, trying to get her sled up. Yeah, it's like, yeah, we're going to be here forever. Down he goes with his dog team, gets up beside her, gets off, pulls her sled up, and he's like, it's time to go. And that was just Lance. He wanted to help everybody, tell funny stories. And the day after he passed, it was super stormy at our house, rain, not rain, but it was really stormy and windy, and I was talking to my mom, and she said, well, that means Lance is on his way to heaven. About an hour later, I'm out mounting the dog a lot, scooping poop. And I heard the loudest thunder clap I've ever heard in my life. There's no rain, just a thunder clap. And I looked up at the sky and I'm like, yep, Lance just made it to heaven.
My name's Lisa, and I've worked for Iditarod for a bunch of years, volunteering and technical. And I became a Lance fan when running the race was running dog was hard work, but running it when you're sick. I mean, this guy. And I didn't know very much about it. And then I became an even bigger fan when he won the Yukon Quest. And then he ran the deck on my Super Off, like right after. And so I was at Rome that year, and he showed up, and I think it was this suit. And it was filthy. But I thought, well, you know, he just ran the Quest, and, you know, I didn't know how many days it was when he was done, but. I said, Lance, congratulations for winning the Quest. And he's like, yeah, thanks. I said, I can't believe you're doing this race too. And he says, yeah, well, my daughter are doing great. And so good luck. And anyway, and then the yearly one night, we were out the first time after he won the Quest. Incredible. Oh, you must have that way. You know, that's going to be hard. And I've also been working at checkpoints. You know, I get to watch the mushrooms taking care of their dogs. And I learned a lot about taking care of dogs and about the mushrooms. And I always think, like, if I were a race of dogs, who's kennel would I want to use? And Lance is definitely one of them. There's some other ones too, but it's the way to care with dogs. And then he would talk to us in the checkpoint. You know, and he was staying at a checkpoint, you know, to visit with him and stuff. And I just always admired his humility and toughness. How we would just talk to anyone.
I have some, you know, I just wanted to touch base on Lance. When I first married Lance, we drove from Indiana down to the Kenai Peninsula. Lance didn't have a dog at all, but that was his passion. He wanted a dog. So you all remember those two last words. So we got some sled dogs and we the house that Lester was talking about. We've got trees and we built and the Salvation gave us clothes to insulate the house. And that's how we started. Kim Osmer gave us some dogs, so we've got some trees and we have a dog bird. And I can say that's not the 20 years later. We went to Fred Meyer's and we still got this. Bye, Baker. Then more dogs, then more dogs, then some well, that's how we kind of started. We soon after that bought some property and you know people just went out from it. Land was a great fishing. We found a spot in Fairbanks, which I had a drinking problem and I'm 7 months sober. But some pretty experiences people, short legal drugs. Our daughter, who is 31, struggled with drugs. We got that for her like 12, 13 birthdays. And she begged Lance for that dog and Lance just had it about no. Well, she talked to me. We got her the dog, she never took care of the dog. Needless to say, Lance still had legal for the baby. And I used to think he was going to die because I think that dog ran every single race or training. One of my other funny stories is while I was standing with Lance, on a request, we were up in a circle and Lance was in the lead, and I was up there with Ali Circle and Jerry Bones was in the opening dinner. And there was a huge storm that was traveling alone in the wilderness. And nobody wanted to go on the mountains. Nobody. And I said, I'm going. Lance says, hey, I got to be there. Like, who's going to handle for it? Not now. I got to go. And General Chief told me, if you go, we're going. General said, well, I'm going. The guy go. People were going up the trail. Nobody was going. I had to go. You know, he went down. He was already going. So I went and I believe Channel 2 Pro has put it to them. So they followed me down and it was a slow, scary, wet knuckle ride down the hill. And when we got down there, Lance went with and he said, I still can't believe we drove down that trail. So those are just a few stories that Lance got his dog back and he was happy. And I'm so glad Lance gave me 15 years of great marriage. It did not give us bad people about it, but he was still his friend. And I'm happy he's in heaven with Jenny and his mom, my mom. Lord, just hope that he's got the original dog. Oh, and Larry. So when Larry was born, there was three dogs that were so ugly. I mean, ugly. But nobody wanted these dogs. He didn't want to see these dogs. So he let me name him. And his name was Larry Curly. Yeah. And so Lance gave Larry and Mo and Curly away. And I begged for him to keep Larry. Well, Lance ended up spading Larry, or neutering Larry, because he was so ugly that he never wanted another puppy other than Larry. Well, as he got older, he gave me a puppy, Wake Up, because he hated white Larry. He was never getting rid of him. Well, one day I was at work, and Lance called me and he said, say goodbye to your dogs. And I'm like, what the heck? What do you mean say goodbye to my dogs? Are you giving them away? He goes, no, they just made my team. What do you mean they just made your team? Like, boy, because this big dude, you look at us and my dog, and you hate Larry. And he's like, no, they just made my team. And I was like, you asshole, those are my dogs. So those are my funny stories of my story about my show. That's a personal show, private, but landtenant.com is the immigration story about my show.
My name is Barb. I just wanted to say that watching Lance over the years from Junior Mushy, Junior Iditarod with the younger Reddington kids, onto eventually onto the Iditarod. My husband was in the 2001 Iditarod with Lance. And it was also Ray Jr.'s first race. Ray finished 34th, Ray Jr. 35th, and Lance finished 36th, and they were coming in during the night. So anytime I had like Dick, we'd see Dick. Is it Lance? And then eventually Ray finished, and then Lance finished. And then Dick told me, I sure thought he was going to beat you. He certainly did eventually, didn't he? It's great to see a lot of Iditarod officials like Joanne Cox, Mark Nordman, Chad St. George was here, Star is here. It's good to see a lot of Iditarod champions that were in that elite group with Lance, like 2001 Iditarod champ Doug Swinley who was a champion in Lance's first race. Jeff King, four-time winners also with Lance, and everyone or anyone that has been in the Iditarod right now, please wave your hand. Good to see a lot of Iditarod volunteers as well that became really good friends with Lance as well as any other mushers. What I wanted to share today is a little bit. I don't know if you've heard that Danny CV has written something about Lance that he shared on Facebook, and to me it just resonates quite a bit of who Lance was. But thinking of Lance, I also think of Hobo, Larry, Zorro, and then when they were running the Iditarod together in 2001, Lance would tell Rainey and Ray that, man, I got a heck of a toothache. I got to get it taken care of when I get back. Well, he found out eventually it was cancer. And then his dogs that he named in honor of his doctors that I know of, Dr. Chung, was his radiologist, by Reddington, has the same radiologist, and Dr. Kroll.
Zero.
Thank you. But I know Kroll and Chung, and Kroll he eventually owned, and I can tell you that was a really good bloodline. But a little bit of what Danny C.B. wrote is going on to say that he was also a rookie with Lance Mackey in his first Iditarod in 2001. The Iditarod is just a dog race, just a big game. But to so many people, it's so much more. It's a hobby, it's a passion, it's a career, and it's a way of life. And then there's Lance Mackey. He is on a level of his own. Lance and the Iditarod are among the best things that have ever happened to each other. I don't think any one person has ever been so dependent on Mushy and has given it so much. Other than a mushing legacy, he didn't have much going. But like one of those kids who grows up in the project and wrecks the NFL, Lance is the kind of guy who made it out, turned it around, and decided to be a musher. That was before he got cancer. If mushing didn't save his life then, it certainly was a big factor. Everyone needs something to live for, and for Lance, it was mushy. He goes on to say he didn't mean to take it away from the love for his kids and his family and etc. But in his heart, Lance was always a dog musher. He goes on to say he's always respected Lance. He's respected the fact that he never forgot where he came from. He never changed who he was. He has helped everyone around him to the best of his ability. Some didn't want help, but they knew it was there. He has loved the Iditarod, his fans, and most of all, he loved to mush. Okay. No one can truly be great at something unless they love it. Lance doesn't love mushing because he wins. He wins because he loved it. He would be the same guy if he'd never won. He didn't love mushing to become famous. He doesn't love being famous. People loved him because he didn't care that he was famous. He loved the dogs, the trail, and the people. That's what made him tick. That's he found his calling. And he goes on to say, ever wonder why Rick Swenson, Sonny Lindner, Dee Genro, et cetera, why they kept racing? They know they're not going to win. They just love to mush. They will do it as long as they can because there's nothing else they want to do. Most people go their whole lives. Most people go their whole lives and never really know what they want. They change majors 5 times in college, take the first job they can get to pay the student loans, and just try to keep up with the mortgage, and they qualify for Social Security. It's sad. They're standing just outside the fire. So that I just wanted to share what Danny Seavey had written. I thought that was pretty poignant. Thank you.
I didn't make any notes. I'm a fan. I'm not family or anything.
I really like the size of this family. I'm jealous. Where I come from, before the internet, you could find an article about the size of this in the Sunday paper on the Iditarod about Susan Butcher and her fight with the moose. So I couldn't find anything. This is sort of pre-internet, where I wanted to get closer to the mushing people, and Lance Mackey's my kind of people. I wore this shirt when I met him. I'll tell you about that in a minute. So anyway, I came up here, landed on Lazy Mountain, landed on Lazy Mountain. I kept my ears to the ground, talked with my bus driver about everything, learned everything I could about what goes on around here in the valley. And one of my routes was Connecticut State Elementary, and Kathy was one of my teachers. And meeting her every day of the morning just made my day. If you can't imagine, you knew where Lance got a sense of humor from. He was just like his mom. So I said, Kathy, I said, Kathy, you're retiring, huh? I got a million-dollar idea for you. Now, you're going to laugh at me. But I said, you know how Lance is always complaining about the fudge and breaking his teeth? I wanted to tell you this. I said, Kathy, the fudge, and you can make us laugh. We need to make Lance Mackey fudge. Now, kind of breaks your teeth or something, you know? So she laughed about that. Moving forward, we're at Meadow Lakes Elementary, and I'm in the bathroom at the teacher's lunch. My driver just hitting on the door. Jane, Jane, come on out. And I'm walking out, there's Lance Mackey standing in front of me. I'm like, ooh. I like them. I had a hard time keeping my tongue in my head. My kind of God. So anyway, as I saw him, I introduced myself proudly, wore my Leonard Skinner shirt. If I leave here tomorrow, will you still remember me?
Yes.
I shook his hand. Your brother had been past the handshake. He just was real people. And I live alone up on the mountain, and I can tell you that the idea ride gives me so much joy. And your brother gave me so much joy when I had nothing in my life. Okay? I want you to know that knowing your mother and knowing your brother was the icing on the cake for me. Okay? I don't do the bus barn anymore, but those were the two best situations that came out of 14 years. Anyway, God bless you all. And I'm envious of what you got. So enjoy what you have while it lasts. Like that lady just said, nothing lasts forever. I just lost my boyfriend this past October, and it's been crazy. So I'm grieving for him. I'm grieving for my boyfriend. And that picture of the queen was really cool. I got to find that. Well, have a great day.
I'm not even going to use the microphone. We're all used to being around loud dog lots, and we all screamed. I'm not screaming at you. I'm screaming at you.
It's for the people at home on the Zooms.
All right. Well, I'm sure they can hear me. 1997, 1998, I think it was, I met Lance for the first time. I was mushing for the Peninsula Sled Dog Racing Association. And we were sprint races. It was point races. And getting ready to win myself another eight dog race. I had an outstanding team, and every single race I put it in, it won. This particular race, this old junky Chevy pickup truck pulls up alongside me. He's got an old Ed Borden toboggan sled tied from door to door on the top of the truck. No canopy on the back of it, six dog kennels in the back, three dogs in the front. It was a, wow, this guy's crazy. And he pulls in and he goes, hey, my name's Lance. I want a race. Let's take the race. So, well, talk to Bigfoot. I remember Bigfoot. And Bigfoot says, well, you need an ice hook and you need a sled bag. Wow, I don't have either one of those. I reached in the back of my dog truck and I grabbed out the biggest ice hook I had, the big Ram Horn ice hook, and I said, I got one you can borrow. Truck on the other side said, I got a duffel bag. That'll work for a sled bag. Let's race. Well, I drew the first position on that race, so I went out first. 2 minutes behind me Lance was behind me. So I got this guy. There's no way this guy's even going to see me. I'm going to be so far ahead of this guy, he's never going to see me. But we got up onto the flats and got around. We got down to Suicide Hill. And I start hearing noises behind me. I said, I'm not looking behind me. Nobody's behind me. Nobody's behind me. Got down the bottom of the hill, and we got to No Man's Land. I also got to feel breath on the back of my leg. And I turned around, and it was Lance's lead dog. He was right behind me. And I was like, this can't be. Well, I did end up winning the race, but it was by seconds. Like, I think 13 seconds, I think, on that race that I won. And we all, at the end of the race, we all went down to the Peninsula Steakhouse and have dinner. We were down there, and I said, Lance, I can't believe that you got that close behind me. And he laughed at me, and he goes, yeah, if you wouldn't have given me that boat anchor, I probably would have beat you. Quite a few years later, I get a phone call from Lance. I was living down in Sterling. I get a phone call from him, and I'm like, hey, what's up? And he says, hey, I got a real bad emergency problem. I'm like, well, what's up? He says, well, I'm on my way to Iditarod. And I said, yeah, I know. He says, well, my truck broke down. I'm not going to be able to make it. I said, well, heck, there's no way possible I could get up there in time to help you out and get you to the starting line. Okay, I think he ended up calling a tow truck. The tow truck took his dog truck, him, and I believe Tonya all together to the starting line on the back of the tow truck. I ended up making it up there, didn't make it up there for the ceremonial, but I made it up there for the official start. And I was helping Lance, I was doing the dog duties, we'll say. And I said, man, you were really, really lucky that you even got here. And he goes, yeah, well, I'm hungry. I said, I'm hungry. No, I don't have a truck, and I'm hungry. He goes, Lou, I'm going to win that truck. I have no choice. I have to win it. You're going to win it. I'm hungry. And he took that number 13, and he turned it into his good luck number, and he won. And all I got to say to everybody out here is, feel the dream. Stay hungry for that dream. Don't forget it. Stay hungry. Lance is still with us. It's in my heart, and will always be in my heart. I volunteer for Iditarod, unofficially, of course, but I've been with through a lot of different dog races. I actually qualified Lance when he ran the Connect 200 way back in the year, and we developed quite a strong relationship. One day he was over at my dog lot, and I had a dog that was absolutely going nuts. I was like, Lance, do you have a female dog that eats in your truck? He goes, no. And he looked over at that dog, and he said, that dog's name is Cinder. Do you remember Cinder? It was your dog. Lance noticed that dog right off the bat and goes, that dog, I need that dog. And I was like, that's one of my better dogs. I don't know how he did it, but he ended up going home with that dog. Dog house. Yeah, Lance, don't forget him. Stay hungry, folks. Stay hungry.
All right, folks, I know there's a lot of people that want to tell stories and such, but after we close the service now, there'll be a lot of time to be able to share that. I would suggest, share those memories with the family and do that. Before I read this poem that I'm going to read, I just wanted to make a couple comments. You know, everybody talked, and everybody knows how tough Lance is and all. And I was fortunate enough, as a friend of Lance's, to be with him, with the family, with CN, with the kids, and with Debbie and And you know, I was saying to CN yesterday that over the last couple of years, and especially the last year, that, you know, I told CN, I said, you know, I feel like we spent 20 years with Lance over the last year. And I don't mean that time dragged on. I mean the stories that we were able to share with one another, the memories, the love that built all the way through. I mean, doggone it, I'm part of the Mackey family now. I asked Dick if they were going to change their last name or if I had to change mine. So maybe Mackey Funeral Home. So, but it was that special climate. And, you know, I'm sorry, but I have to use the word fortunate, that to be fortunate enough to be with him till the end. And believe me, he never gave up the fight. He never gave up the fight. There was no backstroke in the sea of self-pity. There was none of that. He faced everything head on, even when the bad news got thrown out. And he did. His will to live was without a doubt a huge inspiration. Huge inspiration. And I know to all of you, but to be there with him and share all of that, I mean, it was amazing. Dick, I don't know if you heard this, but Dick and I and Lance were in the room up at Matsu Hospital when this all started. And the three of us, I got lucky enough to be in there and share stories with Dick Mackey and Lance Mackey. And we're in there telling stories and laughing. And me and Dick got shooshed by all these women in their family. And, you know, we'd start talking and we both have to talk loud. So we get this shh all the time. But when I walked out of the room that day, the nurses said, you know, what we hear here stays here and everything, but I think we just heard stories that nobody else has heard. And I'm sure they did. I'm sure they did. Now this little poem that I'm going to read, and then we're going to close. Pastor will be coming up right after I read this. But the reason I'm reading this is that I wrote it back. It's a swing on Spell of the Yukon, and I did a turn on it after the 2018 I did a run. And it just happened to be, I have a dog-eared copy of Robert Service. And so a lot of the days that I sat with Lance up in the hospital, I would read him some of the different ones. You know, one of them was The Cremation of Sam McGee. But I'm not going to read that one right now. But this one, Lance would say often that the last day that he had chemo, I was sitting with him, and Sienna had to go back to work after lunch, and so I got to spend about 4 hours with him, and we chatted and the whole thing, and both of us chatted. It wasn't just me, by the way. But he said 4 different times that day, he asked me, can you read that poem again? So that's why I'm reading this. I wanted my dinner rod, and I sought it. I scrabbled and mucked like a slave. Was it deep snow or mountains? I fought it. I hurled my youth into a grave. I wanted Iditarod and I got it. Spent a fortune raising these dogs. Yet somehow life's not what I thought it. And somehow a finish isn't all. No, there's the trail. Have you run it? It's the toughest trail that I know. From the big busy mountains that screen it to the deep death-like valleys below. Some say God was tired when he made it. Some say it's a fine trail to shun. Maybe, but there's some as would trade it for no trail on earth, and I'm one. You come to run dogs, damn good reason. You feel like an exile at first. You might hate it like hell for a few runs, but then you are worse than the worst. It grips you like some kinds of sinning. It twists you from foe to a friend. It seems it's been from the beginning. It seems it will be to the end. I've mushed through some mighty Mount Hollow that's plumb full of hush to the brim. I've watched the big husky sun wallow in crimson and gold and grow dim. Till the moon set the pretty peaks gleaming and the stars tumbled out neck and crop. And I thought that I surely was dreaming with the peace of the world piled on top. There's a trail where the mountains are nameless and the rivers all run God knows where. There are lives that are erring and aimless and deaths
that just hang by a hair. There are hardships that nobody reckons. There are valleys unpeopled and still. There's a trail and it beckons and beckons. And I want to go back. I will. They're making my dog food diminish. I'm missing the taste of the tang. Thank God I feel like I finished. I'll pick to Iditarod again. I'll fight it, you know it's no sham fight. It's hell, but I've been there before. And it's better than anything by a damn sight. So me for Iditarod for life. There's a trail and it's haunting and haunting. It's luring me on as a whole. Yet it isn't the finish I'm wanting. So much as just running the trail. It's the great big broad land way up yonder. It's the forest where silence is least. It's the beauty that thrills me with wonder. It's the stillness that fills me with peace. At this time, I'd like Chaplain Dave to come up, and you'll have the final blessing. And then we're going to have the recessional. There will be a song that starts. And then you'll bring the family out so they can go over to the reception area. And after the family's left, then we'll do row by row. Just, you know, I know you're all workers, and you'll want to be the first ones out of here. So, you know, here's Jeff and Dave. Thank you all much.
You join me at the closing. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for the time we've had here in the last couple of hours. Thank you for the life of Lance Matthew. Lord, we ask your favor on this time that we leave here, that the story shared would be rich and healing. We mean, Lord, for the Matthew family, we pray comfort for them. They will work here. To your honor and glory, we ask all this. Amen.
Thank you.
He appreciated those.
Yeah.
That's the way I am. I stay simple.